Pops. Welcome to the Great Canadian Comic Books. Johnny Canuck, Dixon of the Mountain, Nelvana of the Northern Lights, and many, many others. Yes, sir.
Canadian artists helped to pioneer a new medium, comic book art. Adrian Dingle was the supervising art director for Bell Features. He worked around the clock, meeting the deadlines for some 200 books.
The era of the comic book was a very exciting one in my career. It meant a great deal to me. We had rather grandiose illusions of where it might end, because the American distribution was cut off and Canada was then getting ready to distribute comic books across the border. And we had all sorts of wonderful ideas of solid gold Cadillacs, and everybody was talking exorbitant salaries.
Cy Bell was the king of Canadian comic books. He watched his sign company grow into a full-fledged publishing empire, Bell Features, which employed more than 60 artists over a five-year period.
Originally, they all worked for us upstairs in a floor we had upstairs, but there was too much foolery going on. We couldn't get any work out of them, so we sent them all home, and they came back each week. And Adrian Dingle paid them so much per page, depending on their talent.
Leo Baschel is a stand-up comedian and cartoonist seen here performing at a Toronto nightclub. At the age of 16, he created and drew Johnny Canuck, a popular wartime hero of Canadian comic books.
Actually, I didn't think too much of it as a propaganda strip at the time. I thought of it as giving Canada a hero. He was sort of represented the things I felt that were inside. And this was important, I felt, at the time. I felt that there was a message needed, too. I mean, it was all wrapped up in it. I really believed in the effort against the war at that time, and I felt very nationalistic.
Don't sit under the apple tree. The year
is 1941. Canada has just entered the big war against the Axis powers to fight for democracy. On the home front, the War Measures Act places an embargo on foreign publications, including U.S. comic books, then at their peak of popularity. The result? A Canadian comic book industry is born. In the summer of 41, Cyril V. Bell publishes the first issue of Wow Comics. It's an immediate sellout on the newsstands, and Bell Features becomes the dominant force in the infant comic book industry. For the next 5 years, Canadian heroes grind Axis villains like Adolf Hitler into a void of nothingness. A product of the Second World War, these comic books disappear with the coming of peace. They are forgotten for 30 years.
The throw of the dice.
My brother and I, Gene, were in the rotary litho business at that time. We just secured our first press, and we were in the screen process business. So we had the facilities, the starting of the facilities. Of course, it was wide open market. There was nobody doing it anyway. And we had the start with the artists, and we had a connection with different artists. And that's why we decided at that time we'd go right into it, get some more presses and open up, get some more artists and more of everything and go in and go into that field. Yeah, we financed ourselves. So it took us a year to build that plant. We brought the press up from Cleveland. It took us a year to put that in. And we were rolling off 425,000 editions going back in to beat the Americans when they came over here, besides 100,000 for England and 50,000 for Canada. The first trips we started with were in Wow. It was Dartner Daring and Whiz Wallace were the two main lead strips. It was strictly Canadian. All the stories were Canadian written. They were all new material, and all the artwork was all Canadian. It was all new material. Everything was written right from scratch.
Wow Comics, number one!
Action, thrills, adventure. Shipwrecked on a desert island in the South Seas, Dart Daring discovers a vast treasure in the hold of an old wreck. Came at grip with a wild gorilla and conquered it in a fight. Then they became friends. Days later, Dart and the ape saved a young girl in boy's garb from being tortured by a band of island cannibals. the fight, the ape was wounded.
Come, lad, off with your blouse. This poor beast needs bandaging.
Yes, my lord, but I don't...
Stay the butts, lad. There's no time to argue. A thousand pardons, my lady. I did not realize.
Fatally wounded by a spear, the gorilla died, and Dart buried the faithful beast beneath a pile of stones. The girl, Lorraine Knight, is rightful owner of the hoard in the old wrecked ship, as the dead captain of the ill-fated vessel was her father. Later, while chasing Lorraine's treasure, Dart met with misfortune.
What will be the outcome of Dart's fall into the unknown cave of mystery? Make sure to get your next issue of WOW Comics!
Wow. I can hardly wait to see if Dart and Lorraine are safe.
Dingo was a big artist. He did the second page, the full page illustration in the Star Weekly every week before he started in the comic book business. Well, he started out as an opposition of mine. When I put out WOW and Diamond Active and some of our first books, Triumph came on the market. Their book came out two or three times, but on the second or third edition, they failed to show. So I went around to see the reason it didn't show, and they said they couldn't finance it and they were going to go out of business. So I gave them the deal that I would take over the title, continue publishing their book, and that they would work for me. That's how I acquired the Kullaback brothers and Adrian Dingle, who became later on our art director.
Cy Bell was a very dynamic character. I enjoyed working with him. He was always so full of enthusiasm. And we lived in a sort of a world of fantasy in those days, drumming up these scripts for comic books. And Cy was always a part of it. He was a most magnetic person to work with. He really was. He was astounding. We had some marvelous personalities in the whole group among the artists and with Cy Bell as well. The artists were all diversified in their character, and one was Leo Backel. He was always a very interesting lad to talk to, and his thoughts went into a sort of a, from the macabre to the strongest form of humor, and quite subtly applied.
I got my first ideas about drawing comic strips when I went to Danforth Tech, which was a school in Toronto, and it was rather short-lived schooling because I was... Well, I had a little trouble with school. We got kicked out when we were 15, in the second year of school, along with another cartoonist friend of mine, Ross Sakel. And at that time, well, I also did an article. It's nothing new. We were causing strikes in those days, and I had did a thing on pollution already. And I always remember, we had first-hand information on pollution. We lived in Cabbage Town. That was the part of Toronto where you saw a cat with a tail, you knew he was a tourist. And we used to swim in the Don River, which was full of pollutants in those days, too. And I always remember the police used to chase us. And we were never sure they were chasing us because we didn't wear bathing suits because we left a ring around the bank. And that was pretty hard in the dawn, even in those days. But I recall we were kicked out of school, and I ran away from home and joined the Canadian Army. And I was in it for 5 months before they found out I was 15. And they kicked me out of that after they found out diapers, a lot of diapers in my pack. And then I took a job briefly with an optical company. And I was carrying lenses through the halls one day, and saw a pile of comic books. Typical kid fashion, I picked up the comic books and I was reading them, and a Mr. Ezrin, who was working in the building, came out, looked at me and said, "What do you think of the books?" And I said, they're pretty well done. And he said, "Well, do you think you could do better?" And one word led to the other, and finally I ended up, he had me demonstrate my drawing ability, and he took me down to Cy Bell, who was the head of the Bell Features and Publishing Company, and they hired me at $25 a week, which in those days made me a capitalist because I was making $10 a week carrying optical lenses around.
Yes, I remember Leo quite well. I used to chum around with Leo and Ross Sakel on quite numerous occasions. Leo was quite a boy. He was quite a pugilist. And he and Ross had been lightning artists previously before they started working for me.
The publishers made the money, naturally. I can't kind of blame them. You know, they owned the company, so they made what they could out of it. But at the same time, that we wound up with $6.50 a page, which is all you could make in Canada. They started me in the States at $25 a page. They moved up quickly to $50 a page, and then eventually they were paying me $60 a page. Now, I mean, from $60 a page to $6.50 a page, you can imagine the standard of life you lived in.
You know, Gene, reading this comic book has given me a most enlightening brainstorm.
Yeah, we put Granny Cyril. What's the idea?
I figured that we should give up our present occupation of robbery, violence, and murder, and get into a nice educational racket.
Gee, that's terrific. What kind, Cyril?
Us publishers' comic books.
Gee, Cyril, I knew you had the literate ability to write the scripts, but us ain't artists. How are we going to draw them?
Nah, gee, it ain't artists and writers that mix the dough with comic books. It's the publisher. The artists do all the real work, and the publishers make all the easy dough.
Ah, it sounds like a sweet racket, Cyril.
Well, every Friday when the boys got their checks, we adjourned down to the old Piccadilly Hotel, which was on King Street, just where the North American Life Building is now. Eventually, they tore it down. But every Friday afternoon, all the boys got their checks, and they went over there and had a general comic book session. That's where a lot of the stories were hashed over and future episodes were talked about, and any of the boys who were trapped temporarily for something to write about ironed themselves out and got another month's start on their strips.
Wow. Three more shovels, and Pop says I can read my comics.
Johnny Canuck, Canada's answer to Nazi oppression.
Who are you, and where do you come from?
Johnny Canuck of Canada.
Johnny Canuck, well, I got the idea for it. I really feel like a true Canadian, and it sounds kind of corny, but I'm not a professional Canadian, but I did, back in those days, feel that Canada needed a hero character. We didn't have a character, really. I used to look in the American books and see all the heroes in the English book. Every book had a hero. Every country had a hero. I never had a hero here, and I felt that Johnny Canuck typified the Canadian character. It's a typically Canadian, and what could be more Canadian than Johnny Canuck?
Bronx Munitions Factory sabotage! Johnny Canuck believe responsible!
What does that mean? Why, it's Johnny Canuck!
Okay, Adolf, old boy, just sit tight.
What are you going to do? Don't kill me! I'll give you money, anything, U-boats!
But as Hitler talks, his hand slips stealthily towards an alarm button on his desk. With astounding accuracy, Johnny hurls the bayonet and pins Hitler's sleeve to the desk, but a fraction of an inch from the alarm buttons. Hitler, mad with fear, takes a last chance and boldly draws a Luger from his drawer.
If I must die, I'll take you with me!
Realizing that a pistol shot would bring the German army down on his neck, Johnny dives for Hitler's arm. The Luger discharges.
I guess it's time to pull stakes, but I'll leave this with you, Adolf, old pal.
The feeling during the war, at least that war, it was much different than today. The Vietnam War, people, you know, they're not that stirred up about the reasons for the war. Everyone, I think, during the big war was very concerned. We saw pictures in the papers of babies and impaled on Japanese bayonets, and you read constantly about the gas ovens of Europe, and people really were stirred up, and as you felt that you wanted to do something. I am a peacenik, as I said, but at that time, I was upset. I had visions of them reaching this country and some possible things happening, and I felt that I felt the war spirit, and that I think everyone did. That there was always, we always thought we were going to win. You know, there's no doubt about our invincibility, but there was always that little doubt in the mind that they just might make a landing here. You know, especially the Japanese when they, after Pearl Harbor and stuff, that they just might make a landing, and all these things were in the back of your mind. And I felt that through a character like this, that you actually were sort of fighting it a little bit, and it also inflamed people, showed how great we could be, and it was propaganda. There's no doubt about it. It was propaganda.
Boys and girls, here is a What Would You Do With Hitler and His Gang contest. What would you do with Der Fuhrer, Adolf Hitler, and Hermann Luftwaffe Göring, and Loudmouth Goebbels? Yes, any boy or girl in Canada is eligible to compete in this contest with terrific, yes, terrific prizes for the best letters and drawings.
The comic books we put out were emphasizing the good and the democratic and the true, and denouncing everything that was evil. And of course, the war gave us every opportunity for that.
The sign of freedom.
I dedicate this story to the many thousands of brave souls who have pledged their lives to fight for the freedom cause under the very noses of the inhuman Gestapo.
and who may, one day, be responsible for making a reality of what is, at present, a mere sign. Freedom. Adrian Dingle.
Yes, I think we gave Canada quite an uplift, and the opposition was pretty well beaten every time, anyway.
Well, I feel that comics provided an outlet for children, a sort of an escape, as you might call it, where they could kind of look into another world and go into another world, live an adventure, which all of us like to live at times, just like we would in any adventure story. It also provided for the children an outlet for their aggression. It gave them someone to believe in. I mean, in a sense of these were fictitious characters, but they were characters who helped people.
Corporal Wayne Dixon of the Royal Canadian Mounted Police is caught in the grip of a raging blizzard while searching for Ruth Barton, the girl he loves, who mysteriously disappeared from her home north of Dawson. He discovers Ruth in the clutches of a devil-like creature, the Mountie Freezer. Ruth is again captured by the monster. Dixon finds the monster about to torture Ruth. The fiend rushes at Dixon with an axe.
Now, our books were very clean. We had a committee set up that ruled on any books that before we put them out, and we didn't show anything that wasn't good for kids in our books.
The first character that I was involved in was relative to Franz Johnson, the painter and Group of Seven member, who used to paint in the Arctic quite a great deal. He came back with a lurid story of a fictional character that seemed to influence the Eskimos, and her name was Nelvana. Contrary to her actual physical appearance, which I think was almost an octogenarian and chewing mucklucks, and she was a pretty gruesome-looking character, but we had to put her into a miniskirt and make her into quite an attractive doll.
Nelvana of the Northern Lights and the Ether People.
High in the Arctic Circle, a lonely RCMP outpost, Corporal Keene tries vainly to make his daily report.
Confound these Northern Lights. Can't get through. Never could see the beauty in the darn things.
Suddenly, for the first time in his life, Corporal Keene knows fear.
Who and what are you?
I am an emissary from the ether world. I came here through your radio loudspeaker. We were a peace-loving race until radio began on Earth. Radio broadcasting must stop, or we Etherians shall destroy all civilization.
There's only one person who can help me now. Nelvana.
Corporal Keene tells Nelvana of the strange visitor.
The Etherians are a real race, John. But I never thought they'd breach the gap between the ether wave strata and the Earth.
Nelvana abstractly clicks on the radio. The machine emits an unusual amount of static, but then something more visible than static emerges from the loudspeaker.
Nelvana, look out! This is it! The Ether Man.
Eek! Put down the chair. You cannot harm an Etherian with physical violence. See how helpless you are. There are hundreds of Etherians to every Earthman.
In the name of Koliak the Mighty, I charge you. Go.
Well, the comic book era was, of course, a very short one, and lasted till about 1944. And after that time, we were all out on our ear. There was nothing more in the comic book field. But I was primarily a painter from back in 1931 when I first started to dabble the media. So I concentrated as much as I could on commercial art, on painting whenever I could. Of course, the sales were not extensive in those days, and it was a matter of piecemeal situation. But looking back on the comic book era, I can see that it is a form of training that has stood me in very good stead. Because during that time, we were forced to draw as well as we can, and to draw fast, and to complete the drawings in rapid time. This is extremely good for the artist because it helps him to retain things in his mind, and consequently, when I go abroad painting, even now, and I see something that is transient, I can memorize it because of the training in this field.
Well, we folded up the comic business when we couldn't get enough paper, one thing or another, and all we did then was dispose of our assets for a couple of years. We eventually tore down the big newspaper press, but we were selling equipment for a year or so. A big equipment like that was very hard to sell. We advertised all over the world. There's only one buyer in millions that could use a piece of equipment like that.
Nowadays, the comic strip has relegated itself to a very simplified form of drawing, which is most creditable, and it's much more, perhaps, artistic in a different field. But when you think of the hours of labor that we were forced to put into our comic strips, and then you think in terms of Peanuts today, Schultz's famous strip with its limited line and delineation.
I worked pretty hard all during my life. Well, that wasn't as tiring as sometimes, I guess. It wasn't manual, it was mostly mental. Mental and coming up with the big rabbit every time we needed the big rabbit out of the hat. It's mostly coming up with something that we didn't have and getting it quickly.